The storm won't end there. Because on the third day, he got up. My God is on. Listen, I feel something move. Is anybody
good morning, good morning, good resurrection morning. We're so excited to have you with us on this beautiful day that the Lord has made. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Man, it's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful day. I'm so thankful y'all are with us, worshiping with us virtually. We are able to worship both in Lynchburg, Virginia, in Fort Washington, Maryland. We're able to worship in Sumter, South Carolina, in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. God has been so gracious to us. And because of his graciousness, because of his compassion, because of his loving kindness, not only did he spare us, but he allowed us to see another Resurrection Sunday. And that's just a reason to give him praise, a reason to give him praise. I greet you on the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I am Napoleon Bradford, and I am serving today as guest pastor or guest minister at the Mount Carmel Baptist Church, 800 Cabell Street, Lynchburg, Virginia. And I'm just so thankful to be here this morning with you as we come together to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Man, this is so amazing to have you all on with us. And we're just so excited, so excited, so excited. So I wanted to do something real fast as we continue to encourage you to share this message, to start watch parties, to encourage other people to get on. I wanted to do something quickly, and I wanted to just pause and just take a minute to pray. Let's pray. God, we thank you and celebrate you for this day. We praise you and give you all honor and glory, thanking you for the amazing opportunity to worship on this day. Now, God, we know that you only got up one time, but we continue to remember your getting up to remind us that we too can get up. For if you got up from the grave, we can get up from whatever dead situation, whatever hopeless situation, whatever sick situation, whatever seemingly failed situation, whatever fallen situation we're in. So God, we just thank you, God, for setting the example of resurrection, God. And we're thankful that because of your resurrection power, we too have resurrection power. For you said, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, that dunameo, that explosive energy, that energio, that power that's inside of us that allows us to reproduce what we watched you do. Oh my God. So God, thank you for allowing us to see you resurrect. So now we can reproduce your resurrection in the areas of our life that need to be brought back to life. So God, we just thank you. We celebrate you. We're expecting great things in this worship service. Be with us. In your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Listen, I thank you for being on. I thank you for joining us. It's good to see you. We're going to go ahead and jump into it. I thought about playing a song first, and maybe I'll play just a little bit, but I want us, first of all, to get our Bibles out. So if you have your Bibles, please turn with me please turn with me to the book of John, to the book of John, to the book of John, chapter number 20. John chapter number 20. John chapter number 20. Please, John chapter number 20. And we're simply going to look at three verses this morning. Three verses. John chapter number 20, beginning at verse number 1. It says, now the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Verse 18 says, Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. Please enjoy this quick selection, Just For Me, by Donnie McClurkin, before we get into the message.
What does the cross of Jesus mean? It's for them all to see. It's for them that emblem of your shame. But it means I'm free, yes, from the chains of slavery. And the blood it shed won't let my sins remain. Oh, upon the cross my Savior died. The Lamb was crucified. He showed us love that this world had never.
How many of you are glad that he did it just for you and just for me? Man, that is good news. That is good news. So again, our scripture today is coming from John chapter number 20, verses 1 through 2 and verse 18. And before we get started with the message, I just want to read quickly I want to read two of the verses over again. All right, verse number one says, "Now the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early." Verse number 18 says, "Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord." I want to talk today briefly from this thought, from tomb to testimony, from tomb to testimony. Let us pray. God, it's preaching time. Let your word reach your people, that they may be changed, that those that don't know you confess you, that those that strayed away from you come back to you, and that those that are disconnected reconnect to you and your body. For we know that the church is the body of the Lord. So God, just give them the strength to move from the tombs of their life to a testimony. It's in your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. From tomb to testimony. It's amazing how life can change so quickly. It's amazing how it seems like only a few days ago, things were normal. Things were business as usual. But through the course of just a couple of weeks, we have seen our world turned upside down. We've seen things we used to take for granted now be missing, and we miss them. Simple things like being able to go to the mall, being able to go to the barbershop, being able to go to the beauty shop, being able to sit in a restaurant, being able to assemble with your friends in this warm weather at a cookout. Those things we took for granted, but now, because they're missing, we're missing them. As a result, we have had to readjust and relook at some of the things that were major in our lives. Not only that, though, I think I want to push it, because these changes have caused trauma. And this trauma that these changes have caused has allowed us, or has left room for, things like grief to develop. As a result, many of us have been contemplating through Facebook Messenger and Facebook and Instagram feeds. We've been contemplating all the things that have changed, all the things that are missing, all the things that are not currently active in our lives. And it's caused us to have to look at them as dead things. This change came almost overnight, and as a result, we haven't really had the chance to deal with it properly. And the evidence of that is the fact we still visit the tombs. We still visit those dead things. We still visit those things. And part of what we wrestle with is we have no clear map as to how to deal with it until today. I believe and would like to suggest that this scripture is the epitome of scriptures that help us deal with trauma and dead things, and then transforming that trauma into triumph and eventually moving from the tomb to the testimony. This is Mary Magdalene. And Mary Magdalene has had some rough days recently. In fact, the roughest day probably took place a couple days ago. I was watching a meditation by Dr. Howard John Wesley on Good Friday, and he talked about the trauma of standing at the cross. He talked about the fact that we often give the disciples a bad rap for not being at the cross, but the reality is, it is difficult to stand at the cross and watch your loved ones or loved things die. It's difficult to have to sit there and watch what you love and hold in high regard die. Isn't that where many of us are today? Many of us have been standing at the cross, watching the job that used to be so fruitful and beneficial now lay us off, and our salary go from being one that could accustom and accomplish what we needed to with our bills. Now we're scratching and surviving. So some of us have watched relationships die. Some of us have watched loved ones perish as a result of this pandemic. We've been standing at the cross, and it's resulted in trauma. And now we find ourselves on this Sunday morning looking and hanging around the tombs of our life. But that's not where Mary stayed. Mary ended up eventually coming back with a testimony. So the question is, how do we move from the tomb to a testimony? How do we move from your tomb to a testimony? Well, the first way you move from your tomb to a testimony is you must deal with your dead things in the dark. You must deal with your dead things in the dark. It's right there in the text. It says, now the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark. Oh, you got to catch this, because John's account is so different than Matthew, Mark, and Luke's account. See, Matthew, Mark, and Luke are the synoptic gospel. They pretty much tell the same story most of the time from Mark's primary perspective, with a little spin on it based on the audience they're approaching. But in this case, John, who writes his gospel about 30 years after their gospels were comprised, gives a different spin. See, John's gospel, Mary goes to the tomb by herself. She's not taking any spices. She's going by herself, and she's going to the tomb. Now, you got to catch this, because what we miss by just starting at John chapter 20, verse 1, is the trauma from John chapter 19. Remember, he was left there standing at the cross when he said, "It is finished," when he said, "Into your hand I commend my spirit," and when he gave up the ghost. Then she was watching while Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus took the body, based on John's account, to the tomb and wrapped it and prepared it for burial and then buried it. So she never got a chance to say her goodbyes. She never got a chance to touch Jesus one last time. Now, this is Mary Magdalene. This is one of Jesus's closest friends. This is Mary Magdalene, who in John chapter 11 went into the crowd of men and anointed his feet and his head with oil and wiped his feet with her tears. This is Mary Magdalene, who was there when Jesus raised her brother from the dead. This is Mary Magdalene, who used to just sit at the feet of Jesus and watch him talk. This is Mary Magdalene, who had a relationship with Jesus, and because she didn't get closure, she found herself going back to the tomb. And how many of us, because of a lack of closure, end up going back to the dead things? We visit the dead things trying to get closure. But look at how she did it. She did it alone and in the dark. That's important, because that suggests that she didn't need a crowd. She had to process some things by herself. I imagine that because Mary had the custom of sitting at Jesus's feet, all she wanted to do was just sit at the tomb and have another conversation. And don't we do that? Don't we talk to the dead things of our life? See, what she was going through was grief, and you can't rush grief. You can't hurry grief. You got to process through. And I am sick and tired of people who try to tell us and convince us how we need to deal with the dead things in the life. This is trauma. What we're going through right now is trauma. It's traumatic to not have a job to go through. It's traumatic to now be in your house with your kids, where you now have to work from home and be their primary educator. It's traumatic. And no one from the outside can tell you how to deal with what you're dealing with. You have to be able to deal with it in the dark. But can I tell you the blessing of the dark? The blessing of the dark is there's nobody around to give unauthorized information, unasked for insight. See, part of our problem is when we get on Facebook and Instagram and vent our problems, everybody wants to chime in. But sometimes to get from the tomb to your testimony, you got to deal with it by yourself. You don't need their influence, because you're going by yourself. And can I tell you what blessed me when she got there? Ready to talk to God, ready to deal with God herself what happened was what? The tomb was open and empty, which leads me to my second point. Hold on. Let's push it, because not only do we move from tomb to testimony by dealing with the dead things in the dark, but secondly, you may have to depend on those you felt deserted you. Oh God, this is rough. See, she was cool going to the tomb by herself until she got there and found something she wasn't looking for. She got there and she found the tomb empty. That's what it says in verse 1, right? It says she saw the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Verse 2 says, then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they have laid him. Catch this. You got to catch this because this is major. If you remember, this was hard for her because the reality is Simon Peter and John, the disciple she loved, had deserted her. Oh man, you don't believe me? Peter didn't even show up to the crucifixion. Peter wasn't even in the crowd. Peter wasn't even there, and John left early. In fact, if you look at the harmony of the Gospels, John left at the sixth hour. That's before it even got dark, after the declaration from the cross was made, woman, behold your son, son, behold your mother. And the text says that John left from there at that very hour. So from the sixth to the ninth hour, Mary Magdalene was at the cross with Mary's mother's sister and a couple other ladies. They were there. They had to watch the gruesome end. They had to watch him be pierced in his side. They had to watch him be offered vinegar and gall. They had to watch him cry out, Father, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? And as a result of that, they deserted her, but now she couldn't go on, couldn't get closure until she had a conversation with him. And the reality is, many of us can't move on until we deal with those who we feel have deserted us. Part of the trauma, part of the piece of trauma, is having to still have conversations with those who turned their back on you, with those who left you, with those who walked away from you. See, she still, because she couldn't move forward without going to make amends. Oh man, this blessed me, because I learned that in AA, there are 12 steps. And in the ninth step of AA is going to make amends. That making amends deals with restoration, reconciliation, and restitution. Oh man, it means that sometimes you got to go back and right the wrongs or address the art between you and your brother. Isn't that what the scripture says? The scripture says if you have an offering for the temple and you have art with your brother, you leave your offering and go and make up with your brother. Because the reality is, every now and then, to move from tomb to testimony, you got to deal with those who hurt you. You got to deal with those who left you. You got to deal with those who neglected you. You have to deal with those who you feel walked away from you. And the only way you're going to move is once you deal with them. So she runs back. She gets Simon and John. In fact, the powerful thing is they weren't even concerned. Oh, God. She got up that morning. She went to the tomb. And because it was empty, it was this almost that God preordained for her to heal the situation by going and reconciling with her brothers. She knew that Simon loved. Remember, Simon was the one that boasted about never leaving Jesus' side, but he wasn't there. But now she got the opportunity to get to him. And what happens? They take off running. They take off running to the tomb. When they get there, John looks in but doesn't go in. Peter goes in and sees the cloth lying there and the napkin that covered his head folded up at the end. In other words, because of her faithfulness, she was able to allow them the opportunity to see the miracle for themselves. And I believe that if you go back and reconcile with some people that have hurt you, when you go back and deal with those who you feel have deserted you, then you will allow them to see miracles that they wouldn't have seen unless. See, sometimes they won't tell you that they're sorry. Oh, God, thank you. Thank you. Sometimes they won't tell you they're sorry until you go to them, but they don't realize what they're missing out by not being connected to you. Oh, man, Peter and John would have missed out on the miracle had Mary Magdalene not gone back and gotten him. You got to catch this. You got to catch this because this is major. Because what she's doing, oh, my God, is she's mirroring what Jesus did from the cross. Oh, God, Jesus from the cross, his first word uttered after being crucified was, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's the idea of releasing them from the expectation of an apology. That's the idea of releasing them from the weight of the debt they owe by crossing him. He said, listen, God, I ain't gonna wait for them to say I'm sorry. I'm just gonna forgive them. And because I forgave them, I'm free. Oh, God. And Mary Magdalene said, listen, I'm gonna follow the message of my Father, my Savior, my Lord, and I'm gonna go ahead and forgive you, come and get you, because you don't need to miss out on this. Oh, God, let me push it. Let me push it. Because not only do you move from tomb to testimony when you deal with the dead things in the dark, and not only do you move from tomb to testimony when you have to depend on those who felt deserted you, but here's number three, you move from tomb to testimony when your denial could lead to your delay, but your delay could lead to your deliverance. Catch this, because after John and Peter see what has happened at the tomb, the text says they go back home. After they see that Jesus is risen, they go back home. But look at verse 11. Verse 11 says, but Mary stood outside the tomb weeping. And as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus lay. Catch this. She was in disbelief. She was in denial. She couldn't wrap her head around it. Oh, my God. So she delayed her leaving. Huh. But because she delayed her leaving, she got delivered. Catch this. Oh, man. Listen, that's why I tell you, don't let nobody tell you how long it takes for you to process the stuff you're going through, how long it takes for you to deal with your grief. You stay there till you get delivered. You stay there praying until you cry until you come through. Oh, my God. She was at the tomb weeping. And because she waited weeping, she got to witness something they didn't get to witness. Oh, I'm about to run. Oh, my gosh. I'm trying not to run. The text says when she looked in the tomb, she didn't just see a bedcloth laying there and a towel wrapped. No, she saw two angels. Yeah, she saw it. And sometimes when you just delay long enough, you'll be delivered by some angels. Oh, God, listen, I'm trying not to run. But isn't that what happened to Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane? The text says he went a stone's throw away and prayed. And the text says after he prayed, this is Luke's account, after he prayed, the angel from heaven strengthened him. And sometimes it's in the lowest of your lows that God shows up like with an angel, or sends an angel, or sends a message to you in the midst of your misery to allow you to be strengthened. She looked in the tomb. That's what the text says. I'm not making it up. The text says it right there. The text says she looked in the tomb. And when she looked in the tomb, she saw two angels. But that's not where it gets good, because as she's talking to them, right? They said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said, because I don't know where they've taken my Lord. I don't know where they've laid him. When she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't know that it was Jesus. Oh, because in your grief, sometimes you don't recognize familiar stuff. Hold on, because it gets better. Because look at this. And Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? And she, supposing him to be the gardener, said, sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. And she turned and said to him, Rabboni, which is to say, okay, listen, maybe you're not shouting because I'm about to run out this room. Because she was delayed due to her denial, she got delivered. The brothers ran away. They went back home because they was cool just seeing an empty tomb, but she had some unresolved answers. And because she had unresolved answers, she stayed at the tomb until she got some clarity. She stayed, and sometimes you just got to hang around. And if you hang around long enough, the Lord will show up and he'll talk to you himself. Oh my God. He called her by name. Oh God, aren't we glad that we serve a God that in the midst of our tears can call us by name and provide clarity to our situation? Aren't we glad that we serve a God that can recognize the woes, the hurts that we're going through and step right in and see? Oh my God, maybe you missed it. See, the angels could have been the ones that stayed there. But even after the angels, he knew that that wasn't enough. So he came himself. And every now and then God realizes that a message is not just what you need. A sign is not just what you need. Sometimes you need for God to show up God's self and give you the clarity you need. I'm done. So let's review. How do you deal? How do you move from your tomb to your testimony? First of all, you must deal with the dead things in the dark. Secondly, you may have to depend on those who you felt deserted you. Thirdly, your denial could lead to your delay, but your delay could lead to your deliverance. But I got one more. Here's the last thing. Last thing says, I must have erased it. So here's the last point. The last way that you move from your tomb to your testimony is you remember you were delegated because you were the designated survivor. You remember you were delegated because you were the designated survivor. Oh man, I'm trying not to run, but look at what it says. It's right there. Verse number 18 says, Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. Catch it. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Oh God, don't miss it. Everybody else had gone. So because everybody else had gone, the only person left was Mary. And because Mary was there, she got to meet Jesus. And because she got to meet Jesus, she got to be the one to go tell the message. The word told in the Greek is the word that means to proclaim, to bring good tidings. Oh my God. In fact, to be honest, Mary Magdalene becomes the first carrier of the gospel. She's the first one to tell anybody that he rose from the dead. Mary, a woman who's the first one to tell the good news. Why? Because the brothers weren't there. She was the designated survivor. Oh man. So you rebuke anybody that tells you women can't preach. You rebuke anybody that say women can't preach or bring a message. No. Or can't pastor. She was the one that brought the message to the disciples. She did it. Why? Because she was the designated survivor. Oh my God. Let me just tell you, if you just hang around and wait till your issues get resolved, wait till you get clarity in the midst of your chaos, you'll be the one who survived and you'll be the one delegated to tell the testimony. And all I'm trying to say is there's some people talking to me right now. There's some people watching me right now who've been through some stuff and you've been depressed because of what you've been through. Let me change your perspective, baby. The fact that you can even think about depression suggests that you survived. And because you survived, you got something to say. So all I'm saying is move out of the tomb, get out of the graveyard and go tell it on the mountain. Go tell the good news to somebody. Tell them you survived. Tell them I had cancer, but I'm here. I was broke, but I'm here. I was lonely, but I'm here. I was about to lose my mind, but I'm here. And the only reason I'm here is in the midst of me going through, Jesus showed up. God, and I need you to learn that once Jesus has shown up in the midst of your tomb situation, you move from trauma to triumph, and you then have a testimony. So right now, wherever you are, text somebody and tell them I survived, and all because of my Savior. Woo! Text them, say I survived all because of my Savior. I didn't lose my mind because Jesus showed up. I didn't become suicidal because Jesus showed up. I didn't drink myself into a stupor because Jesus showed up. I put the weed down because Jesus showed up. I put the Hennessy down because Jesus showed up. I started paying my tithes because Jesus showed up. I was able to change my tomb situation into a testimony, all because Jesus showed up. I'm a designated survivor. Yeah, I see it. I'm a designated survivor. I'm a designated survivor. And I'm able to tell somebody about you have been commissioned to be the Mary Magdalene of 2020. You have been commissioned to talk about the trauma. Don't be afraid of it. Don't let nobody shame you for what you've been through. No, you deal with it. And when you're strong enough and get reprieve and feel that the Lord has released you, then you go tell the world that there is a Savior who showed up in the midst of your sorrow and gave you permission to spread the good news. Oh my God, you are a designated survivor. So now Mary leaves, once coming to see the tomb, but now she's going to tell the good news. She has moved from tomb to testimony. Let us pray. God, we thank you. We praise you. We celebrate you today. God, we give you all glory. Thank you for survival, God. Thank you for allowing us to survive. Thank you. Even though we're broken, we've survived. Even though we're hurting, we're surviving. And though we're surviving, we can't just survive. We have to share the source of our survival. We didn't survive because of medicine. We didn't survive because of jobs. We survived because of our Savior. So God, we thank you for helping us survive. And because we've been designated, we're now delegated to go tell somebody else about you. We praise you and celebrate you. In your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Listen. Listen. Man, I can't end this. I can't end this without giving you an opportunity to connect to Christ. Giving you an opportunity to connect to Christ. If you want to be saved, if you want to give your life to Christ, if you want to give your life, if you feel that the Jesus we talked about that shows up in your shame, that shows up in your sorrow, and that shows you that you must share your message, if you've never been connected to him, I want to offer Christ to you. It's not a difficult process. The Bible just simply says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So if that's you, if you just want to give your life to Christ, then simply inbox me at TLCCyber or email thelifecentercyber@gmail.com. Maybe you've confessed Christ, but you strayed away. You doubted him. You didn't believe in him. You gave up on him. You walked away because of the hurt. You don't understand what's going on. And you, because of the trauma of what's going on, it's allowed you to be disconnected and to lose touch. But you hear God saying today that you need to move from your tomb and grab your testimony, and you want to restore your relationship. Then same thing, inbox at TLCCyber or email thelifecentercyber@gmail.com. If you need prayer, same thing. Just put your prayer request in email or inbox, and we will reach out to you today. And if you want to look for a church in your area, if you're in the Lynchburg area, I encourage you to check out Mount Carmel Baptist Church. But if you're not in the Lynchburg area and you are watching and need a church home, reach out to me, inbox me, so that we can connect you to a church home in your area, to a church home in your area. It's very important that after you give your life to Christ, after you restore your relationship to Christ, that you connect to a place that will continue to feed your growth, that will continue to disciple you and help you walk through. You're looking for a place where you feel the power of God, where you get to be loved on by the people of God, where you learn about the presence and promise of God. You're looking for a place like that. So if that's you, inbox me or email me. Now, if you want to make a contribution, if you want to connect through contribution because the message was good, it added value to your life, it brought hope back to you, and you now want to sow, you can send your offering to Mount Carmel Baptist Church, 800 Cobble Street, Lynchburg, Virginia. You can mail it in. You can call them. They may have a different apparatus for you to receive it. And so you can do that. You can do that. That's all. That's an option. Make sure send it in a card. That's the address. If you want to sow into the Life Center, you can do so. That stuff is scrolling at the bottom of the screen. Again, your contributions are appreciated. Oftentimes, it's good to sow into a good word. Sowing to a good word produces fruit from that word. And the reality is many of us are going through this trauma and we have not yet been able to tell a testimony. So we bleed in Facebook. We bleed in Messenger. We bleed on Snapchat. We bleed on Instagram. Not telling the testimony, but always talking about the trauma. But today, I encourage you to put the negative song, the negative story down, and begin to tell the testimony that even in your sorrow, Jesus shows up. Even in your pain, Jesus shows up. Again, we bring you greetings from the Mount Carmel Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia. We thank you for worshiping with us. We thank you for sharing with us. We pray God's richest blessings upon you. We love you. It's Resurrection Day. And if Jesus got up, then we can get up. If Jesus got up, then we can get up and be strong enough to come back to the place of our hurt unaffected. Whew! God, did you catch that? Oh, man. Jesus was left dead in the tomb. But in order to get the word out, he came back risen to the same place he was once dead in. And able to give a word to Mary to tell people that they thought I stayed in the tomb. But I didn't stay there. The tomb was not strong enough to keep me. And you need to remember that whatever you're going through, it's not strong enough to keep you. And when you come out, you go back to those same people who thought you would have stayed there and you tell them, I'm no longer in the tomb. Now you go run and tell that. All right, I got to go. I'm about to preach again. Lord, listen, I thank you. I thank you for joining us. I pray again, God's richest blessings. Share this word. Share this word. We love you. We love you. To God be the glory.